Hello, everyone. I was listening to my favourite podcast, The Strategy Sessions, which means that they were talking about some magnificent speakers, which means that I decided not to, go organic and talk off the top of my head, because I only open my mouth to swap feet. So I'm going to go precisely from my notes, which means that you'll be enticed, inspired, incisive and refreshing, which are her own words. She's the author of the brand book, which is on sale at Amazon. She runs the Marketing Academy Foundation, a registered charity supporting young people from under-resourced backgrounds to start careers in marketing. She appeared on Mad Women about women who shaped the ad industry. We've got a proper titan in our midst this afternoon. And she also founded the Camden Dog Lovers Association, of which she is the chair and her husband, the only other member. That's a bit of person. We're going to talk about the story of Dove. Can I have a rapturous round of applause? Daryl Fielding.
Thank you. Great introduction. Great to see you all here. Just to give you a clue, there's quite a lot of people in the world who claim that they did the Dove campaign. You know, kind of one of the things I would say is I was one of the original team from a blank sheet of paper to launching the campaign in 70-odd countries worldwide. So I'm the real deal, I'm going to tell you some of the sort of insider story that isn't always the public narrative of the of what happened, things we got wrong, things that we did to sell the campaign internally. So this is the true story of a campaign that's lasted for 20 years. I can't quite, nearly 19. I can't quite believe it's that long, actually. And whenever I get asked to do this story, I was like, oh, not again. I feel like Frank Sinatra singing My Way. People still want to hear it. They still find it's inspiring. So I hope that you will as well. So let us crack on, because I'm a shocking overrunner. I usually get away with it, which is why I don't behave myself normally. But I'm going to try and do this to get you off to your coffee break on time. So where did it all begin? Well, it all began after the Second World War, would you believe? It was the product was invented by a doctor who was washing patients with soap and found that it would dry their skin and break their wounds open. So he invented a new product that wouldn't do that, which was actually not soap at all. It's a different kind of product. And then a company called Unilever got to hear about this and they bought the patent for it and decided to launch it. They bought the patent in 1953 and they decided to launch it as a beauty bar in 1957. That makes it sort of about the same age as me, actually, which is sort of slightly alarming as well. So they sold the product in America. It was launched in America, actually by Ogilvy, the agency Ogilvy that I worked for when we did this campaign. And they did nothing with it, really, and for about 30 years. And it was just trucked along, selling bars of not soap for quite some time. And then they woke up, Unilever woke up to the idea that the patent was going to run out. So they decided, we're going to just, you know, let this be a little bar and do nothing with it, or we're going to go for broke. And they decided to go for broke and make it a great big global brand. And that really started in the sort of, you know, the late 80s, last century. And they began this worldwide rollout, which would always start with testimonials and what they called a proof ad, which showed how it performed against, sort of more alkaline products. So they took this product to every country, and then after that, it was followed by other categories of launch. So shower liquids, shower gels, deodorants. In Japan, they launched it with face care. And then just around about the turn of the century, they launched a shampoo into shampoos. And I actually did the European launch of the shampoo and conditioner range, which required 22 countries having two different testimonials in every single country. It nearly broke me trying to find people to be interviewed about their use of the product. So we're sitting there, you know, with this huge, huge global brand and looking forward. So in 2004, looking forward as we were in 2001 to 2004, basically the product was sold pretty much everywhere where they had water. And if you are a big brand and you're in a big company and you've been growing and growing and growing, like the sort of, you know, theoretical illustration, you're going to go, oh, hello, how are we going to grow? Because we've been growing by adding categories, we've been growing by adding countries. There was very, very little headroom. So it was a bit of a sort of, you know, difficult one. How are we going to grow from here? And Dove was huge. People forget how, you know, enormous Dove was. At that time, it was almost a third of the sales of half of the whole company in Unilever. You know, Lynx Axe, which everybody goes, oh, it's a bit, Lynx is amazing. It's tiny. Who gives a shit what Lynx does? You know, it's absolutely minute compared to this, the powerhouse brand, which was Dove. So what we did, if we couldn't grow it, it would have affected the share price. You know, it was a huge brand that really mattered. They'd done everything sort of that they could think of, and it was sort of, well, where then? And up until that point, we'd really had a bit of a formula. We'd done two types of advertising. I mean, I didn't do all this. This was sort of before my time. I haven't been doing this since I was in the cradle. You know, there'd been testimonials, you know, what I would call, frankly, a sappy bint talking about, you know, how she got the moisturiser, and you know her elbows were so lovely and smooth. She got a boyfriend. I mean, that was the calibre of the work. I kid you not. It was like, you know, and if you watch the global reel, the global show reel, which I had done of 200 commercials full of women like this from Taiwan and the Philippines and South Africa, Australia, Scotland, whatever, you wanted to put pins in your eyes. The objective proof ads are actually somewhat better. You know, a few thumbprints on a bit of litmus paper, frankly, was light relief after all the rest of it. 70 countries, 5 categories, where on earth was the growth going to come from? It would have to come from those existing markets. We weren't going to launch anything else. We had unguents for practically every part of the body by that point. How are we going to grow? Well, we would have to increase loyalty. And one sort of miracle that we'd uncovered looking at the data was people tended to buy only in one category. So they would buy a deodorant but nothing else, or they'd buy the bar and nothing else, or shampoo and nothing else. So we actually wanted to drive cross-category usage, which, if you like, is, you know, really directing us more towards a brand campaign as opposed to, you know, kind of an unguent by unguent exposition. But we did some global research as to what the customer thought, and there's a technique called projective techniques, which you're probably aware of, where you ask your customer, you know, if Dove were a girl at a party, what would she be like? And we asked customers all over the world, and pretty much to a woman, they actually said this. If Dove were a girl at a party, she's very nice, she's only going to have one drink, and although she's very nice, she'll be glad she's gone, because the fun will begin. So, not exactly the most resonant of brands. And nor could Ogilvy turn around and go, well, who did your advertising last time? We'd had the account since 1957. So, you know, I'm amazed we weren't fired, but we weren't. And I'd always want to credit the person at Unilever that owned this brand, the most wonderful Brazilian lady called Silvia Lanyardo, who was the global brand director at the time. And she had, you know, tremendous ambition. But the first thing she did was ask the question, which is always worth asking if you're doing any kind of brand repositioning or even marketing, you know, which category are we in? And she reframed the category. She was thinking, we've always thought of ourselves as a sort of toiletries brand. We're a cleansing brand. But with face care and with shampoo, we're really in the beauty category. So we are going to be positioning ourselves in a different category. And she had ambition. She wanted to be as iconic as Apple and Nike. And I know they would go, oh, not them again. I mean, I'm just telling you what we said at the time. You know, we actually wanted to be, we had the aspiration to be as powerful a brand as Apple and Nike. And if you doubt that Apple is a powerful brand, you know, you try and give some Mac user a PC on their first day at work, and I'd pay tickets to watch that show, I have to be honest. It would be very funny. But We didn't really know why they were so good at the time. You know, there was no discourse whatsoever about purpose branding or anything like that. So Sylvia picked up the phone to the CMOs of both companies and sort of said, why are you so good? We really admire you. I'm the girl for the deodorant company and you know, we really think you're awfully good and we'd quite like to be similar. And sort of they spilled the beans, probably thinking, well, we're never going to be much of a challenge. But what they stood for was clear. Apple was all about creativity. Nike was all about empowerment. And what we deconstructed what they told us. And what we said at the time was, you know, iconic brands tend to have a strong emotional attachment by users, hence the PC, Apple, Mac user thing. They also had a set of beliefs or a manifesto that they all held very, very dear. They stood for something deeper and more meaningful than just what they did for a living. And they had some social relevance beyond what the product did. And, you know, again, at the time, there was nobody had used the term purpose branding. This was new thinking in about 2001, which is when we began this work. We'd already looked at what we thought the values of Dove were, and we defined those quite clearly. I'm quite fond of looking at brand values, actually, to determine brand strategy, but it does slightly depend on what kind of brand you've got. And we'd come up with these five things. Real, beautifully uncomplicated. We thought simple, but then it would be basic. And that was the best way we could describe something that we felt, you know, was Dove at its best. Timeless, again, we wanted to be cool. We didn't dare put it on a chart because we thought somebody in Kazakhstan is going to get hold of it and do cool and we're not going to like the outcome. No insult intended to Kazakhstan, but a remote market will misinterpret what we mean by cool. Eye level, lots of brands in this category are very, very patronising, want to be eye level, and we want to do what we say we're going to do. We want to be honourable and honest. And those were the values that we'd come up with. And then there was a team of five. We were like, okay, we're going to have to go now and find this reason for being, this manifesto. And this was the five of us, and my name's at the bottom of that list. I was the only person from the ad agency involved in this particular project at the time. Sylvia's now sort of a non-exec director, and I think is a director of Natura, a Brazilian beauty company. Alessandro has just taken over the Dove brand again at Unilever after being sent off to run ice cream for a while, but I had lunch with him about 6 months ago, and I'm so proud of what he's been doing recently. And then, you know, a couple of other people who are doing amazing things as well. And we sat down and sort of scratched our heads and like, okay, we know what we're going to do. How on earth are we going to do that? So the first question was, how do we play in beauty? We need to be true to Dove, and we'd sort of defined that, but we're going to have to be different. And we had one commercial that was a testimonial, which was not a sappy bint eulogising about her smooth elbows and the new boyfriend that she'd acquired as a consequence. There was a lady that really, really inspired us to think this is Dove at its best, and it's a lady called Jean Shy. This was a commercial that ran in the US in the 80s. And if you think about the context at the time, you know, the ads were full of, you know, Amazonian blondes. You had Bo Derek, you know, running down a beach with, you know, lovely sort of plaits in her hair. You know, every front cover was boofy hair, very perfect, mostly, you know, mostly sort of white and blonde. So that was, you know, the images of beauty that were very much out in the US at the time. And this is what Dove ran at that time, and this was a massive inspiration for us.
The other Sunday I went to church, and I wasn't wearing any makeup or anything. And Reverend Walker, my minister, he came up to me, because we know each other very well, and he said, Jean, you know, your skin looks really nice. And I said, well, I've been using Dove. And he said, well, Jean, it must be the Dove.
Dove contains 1/4 moisturizing cream. It won't dry your face like so.
Dove makes my face feel softer, more feminine, less dry. And when Reverend Walker gave me that compliment, I loved it.
That's quite transgressive, even, you know, particularly for the US, because she's flirting with her minister. She's flirting with her priest. Now, what she did also say, but they didn't quite have the guts to put it in the commercial, was Reverend Walker may be a minister, but he's a man. So, you know, still back to the benefit of getting a boyfriend, but you know, what can you do? But she was great because she had character. It was a true story. It drove sales like you wouldn't believe. It was so different. And we had that as inspiration when we were looking at the competition. And this is what the competition looked like at the time. L'Oreal, Nivea, Olay, Pantene, Neutrogena, huge mass market brand in the US. Shiseido, mass market brand in Asia. And to be honest, you know, apart from the fact that the girls look, you know, very, very slightly, kind of Eastern Asian, they all look the same, don't they? All these women, you know, they're all teenagers, they're all airbrushed to within an inch of their lives. You know, they're all super thin. They look as though they could do with a good lunch rather than whatever unguent they're actually flogging. And so we were, you know, this team of us, which was two guys and three girls, you know, we were sitting there looking at all this. We literally had this up on a wall. I'm like, God, these ads make us feel shit. And Kathy Parker said at the time, she said, they all are designed to make you feel bad. Surely there is a better way to operate in this category. So we're sitting there going, well, you know, I wonder if it makes everybody feel bad. I wonder if it's just us. You know, let's go find out. So we developed a hypothesis that the ads made us feel crap. They were designed to leverage our feelings of insecurity that we didn't quite measure up. And there must be a way to be positive in this category. And we actually decided, instead of going and doing research, which the very wonderful Mark Ritson always says at this time, the Dove team, they did research and 2% of women found they were beautiful. This was absolute bullshit. We did not do this research at this time. We actually went and talked to some psychologists. And I do think if you look for human insights, looking in a different place, don't ask the customer to tell you what they think and feel. They mostly can't deconstruct that. But we went and spoke to psychologists to validate that theory. We spoke in particular to Susie Orbach, who was the psychologist that had treated Princess Diana for bulimia. But we spoke to other people, and they were like, you are so right, that is a thing. You're not, you know, it's not just you, you know, everybody feels the same. We can prove it, there's scientific studies, et cetera, et cetera. So we put it into a video, which was our sort of insight video that we were prepping to pull together our strategy for the brand. And this is the video that we made.
The beauty industry in general plays into women's insecurities. We know that if you measure girls' self-esteem before they read a magazine that's aimed at them, by the time they get to the end of the magazine, their self-esteem has dropped 10 points.
I'd kind of, I don't know, pick up the video thing I've seen and look at, say, someone in Victoria Beckham or something and just think, I want to be like this. And I'd write down on a piece of paper how I could do it, no snacks, no seconds, no puddings, no chocolate.
Was lecturing somewhere and a 12-year-old girl got up in the audience and said this great thing, just, you know, the condensed version of everything. She said, I don't look at beauty magazines, they make me feel ugly.
8, 9, 10, how do you imagine your life in the future? They're full of wonderful stories. One girl, I remember her so well, she said, when I grow up, I'm going to be a vet because my dog died of dog leukemia, and it was so sad, and I never want any other kids to have to go through it like I did. So if I can invent the cure, I'll be so proud. Then at 15, I asked her, Rachel, when you grow up, how do you imagine yourself in the future? And all she could focus on was how she hoped she looked.
No one's perfect, so I feel as if I've got a mend. And the part that isn't perfect about me and make me perfect.
And just the effect of seeing lines airbrushed off of women's faces in a completely improbable way made women feel ugly, you know? And women got sick of feeling ugly. And what they don't want anymore is to be told that there's something wrong with them, is to be told there's something unnatural about aging, or that you know that there's something that they have to cover themselves up to look like someone else.
I don't think that any of us are interested in not looking gorgeous, but I think we want to look our own gorgeous. And aspirationally, I think if you know you feel as good as you possibly can, you're freer to get on with the rest of your life. Research suggests that 80% of women in this country, across race and class and culture, by virtue of the fact that they are just adult women, wake up in the morning and feel inadequate physically. They feel too fat or too unattractive or too big.
If Dove can contribute to transforming that by finding the beauty in all of us and making that sparkle, I think they will have done a fantastic job in changing the social circumstances and individual circumstances of girls and women.
We were wildly excited that we had an amazing, universal, very big, deep insight from which to build our campaign. But we were also incredibly conscious of the commercial realities of the scale of the business and the fact that this was actually going to have to work. And I recalled a book I'd read called Good to Great, which analyses the long-term stock market performance of companies versus which have purpose or have beliefs, versus companies that are very, very similar that don't. And it's the stock market returns are about 7 times for those purpose-driven companies. So we knew that we were going to have to convince quite a lot of, very sort of senior stakeholders, of our intent and that it was going to be a good thing to drive sales. And this was a killer app for doing that. So we started to sort of refine our set of beliefs, etc. And this is word for word what we had at the time, perfect or imperfect. This is what we had from the time. We believe in being beautiful. We're not against being beautiful. Women want to be beautiful, but they don't want to be told exactly how to look and have unreasonable things presented to them. And our belief was every woman can feel beautiful by liking herself, taking care of herself and creating her own personal style of beauty. And interesting, that connection between the product, what you're selling, and your purpose is hugely important. And it's what in this huge maelstrom of debate people forget. The act of grooming in and of itself makes women feel better. If psychologists are treating women for low self-esteem, they will suggest, get your hair done, get your nails done, have a nice, fragranced bath. So our business was not at odds with this purpose and our ambition to be bigger about it either. And it took us a while to figure that out because we're like, well, how can we do this when we're actually selling that? But we did get to it in the end. Anyway, the definition of beauty we felt at the time, far too narrow. It makes the beauty game less joyful and creates hang-ups in women who don't feel they match up. What are the stereotypes? Only thin, only young, only blonde, straight hair, only tall. I was so thrilled because I'm 6'1", so I thought, oh, goody, I got one of the list at least. Physical features count. Only perfect physical features are beautiful, must be perfect. That little girl in the video, I want to mend everything in me that isn't perfect. I mean, it still breaks my heart, and I've seen it 100 times. So our big brand idea, as we wrote it at the time, was that we were going to be about a celebration of diversity. And we're going to have as our sort of manifesto that we believe that beauty comes in different shapes, sizes and ages, and that real beauty can be genuinely stunning. And our mission, we might have too many missions and visions, but this is what we had at the time. It's the true story. To make women feel more beautiful every day by widening today's stereotypical view of beauty and inspiring, different from aspiring, women to take great care of themselves. So we had all this down, we had the charts, we had the video, and then the first thing we did was we shared it with my direct client, who was a guy, who ran the European category of skincare for Unilever, and he said, I'm sure this is a great strategy for ugly women, But I'm sure most women will not feel like this about it at all. Now, of course, we were the group of women that had come up with this bit of mischief. We were enormously complimented by his perspective. But to be honest, he went back. His name is Klaus. I'm still friends with him. And he went back to his lovely wife, Claudia, who is very lovely. And he said, "How do you feel about the way you look?" 2 hours later, when she had stopped telling him about her thighs were fat, she had thin hair, she couldn't use a conditioner, you know, every day she struggled, he was like, "Oh my God, if my gorgeous Claudia feels this way, it is a universal insight. You know, the ugly band that have invented this have clearly got something. I'll come back and I will tell them that I was wrong." And, you know, great humility. And I credit him for actually listening and being curious and coming back. But we still had other men to deal with. And what tended to happen when you would present this sort of strategy to women, they would go, "It's brilliant. Go, sisters, what can I do? It's fabulous. How come nobody else has done this? I'm in." And when you took the strategy to men, they would tend to go, "Really? You don't think you're beautiful? Of course you're beautiful. You're women." And we would go, "Well, you know, to be honest, we spend most of the day worrying about the size of our arses." And, "Yeah, well, your arses are fine." You know, and we just got complete bafflement. And, you know, it was fair enough. They didn't see us as we saw ourselves. So at that time, and I suspect still, you know, very senior people at Unilever were mostly men. And they were going to be the people that were going to have to say yes to this. From the chairman down, it was that big a deal to do something radical with a brand of this size. We were going to have the chair, the chief executive, the, you know, senior category leaders. We were going to have all of their agreement. And we're like, "Well, God, what are we going to do? How can we convince them?" So I came up with this idea that was a bit of a sort of development from the Claudia Klaus conversation. I said, "We've got to do vox pops. We've got to do vox pops with the women that they love." And so at the time, of course, there was no privacy. So Sylvia got all of the home phone numbers of all of the people that we needed to influence from HR. And she rang them at home, got hold of their wives, and said, "We're doing a secret project. You cannot split. You must not tell your husband. Do you have daughters? Could we interview them?" And, you know, the sisters did not split, which was pretty impressive. And then we created a video with the daughters, and then we had like a military operation. We had, this next slide is a dramatic reconstruction. It's not a very interesting one, but there it is. We had a military operation of, you know, basically who we were going to go and see, who was going, what we were going to do, what we were going to present, you know, to basically the local brand teams, which was a group of 400 people. You know, so it was right from the top, and we weren't stupid, we went straight to the chairman, because frankly, if he loves it, you know what corporations are like, everybody's going to love it, aren't they? So, you know, we did start right at the top, and also, to be honest, it wouldn't be a good use of resources if he was going to veto it later, and then we'd look really stupid. But this is the video, and I was really interesting with Andy talking earlier about emotion and B2B, and internally persuading people is often a very rational process, isn't it? And I think the thing we got right here was we got head and we got heart. You know, we had all the slides, we had the insights, we had the cross-category usage, we had the purpose, we had all that in a nice presentation. And we go and we'd explain it all, and we'd explain how we wanted to be different and how everything was homogenous, all the stuff I've shown you. And then we said, if that isn't enough to convince you, we'd like you to show this video, we'd like you to watch this video. And in the video would be the daughters of the people in the room at the time. And we did different edits for every meeting. So you imagine you're sitting there as, you know, Mr. Bigwig Unilever, and you see this video, and in it is your little girl, because that's what we did. And here's the vid.
You are so beautiful.
That's
how many
seconds I've got.
To me, can't beautiful to me.
So everybody cried. And said, you can do it. So it's either really smart or the most shameless piece of emotional manipulation in corporate history. But anyway, you have to do what you've got to do. And I still find it quite moving, funnily enough, as I've done this presentation, as I intimated, you know, quite some years now. So, you know, I still think it rings very true. So then, you know, on my desk lands the first brief, the first creative brief. This has all been PowerPoint until now. You know, and videos, and suddenly you go, shit, we've got to do it. We've been told somebody's not stopping us. Oh my God, we've got to do it. And we had a gift. I mean, talk about luck. If we'd been given a deodorant ad to do, we struggled forever to get deodorants to fit into this, but we had a gift of a brief, which was a new product, a firming lotion, and our proposition was with new Dove firming lotion, you'll want to show off your curves. That was the brief. You'll want to show off your curves. And we came up with a really fabulous idea. We thought we would recreate iconic images of curvy women, like the Marilyn Monroe picture of her with the dress blowing up with the grating, Venus rising from the seashell, you know, the Man Ray violin. We would create a series of pictures that are famous, but the models we would use would be real women. So really fantastic idea. So that's what we did. We commissioned a photographer, fantastic photographer called Ellen Von Unworth. You may have heard of her. I spent a lovely afternoon in Paris talking about shoes and dresses and everything, what we're going to do and who we're going to cast. We found a shoe shop assistant from Croydon, and for those of you who don't know London, Croydon is not the most illustrious suburb, but, you know, Charlotte from Croydon was flown to Paris, and Ellen photographed her, and this is what came back. Okay. So we had no idea what this was going to look like at this stage. We had a picture of Queen Latifah, that was all, as our sort of inspiration, actually. And then a whole series of misadventures occurred, and people in agency world will probably get this. So the art director who'd gone and done this was so excited, he sent it straight to the client without showing the creative director first, or me, who was running the business. He just sent it straight to the client, the lovely Klaus, who with a wife called Claudia, if you recall. And Klaus was like, oh, it's not quite what I was expecting. And he phoned the creative director directly. Picked up, oh, hello, Klaus. Doesn't ring him very often. He said, have you seen the picture? And of course, Klaus hadn't seen it, even though it was in his... the creative director hadn't seen it, even though it was in his inbox. And instead of lying, he said, oh, no, I haven't. Let me have a look. So he opened it while they're on the phone, and he went, oh, my God, I think we've screwed this one up. This is not what I was expecting either. And Klaus said, I'm really, really glad you said that, because I don't think we've got this right. So we had to tear up and start again. That picture cost 40,000 euros. I mean, it wasn't a cheap photograph. And I was the one freaking out. The client will expect us to pay. I'll have to write the money off. So, you know, but I'm so glad that that sort of unhappy accident created a moment of real honesty between two people who were trying to do something. And actually, Unilever, Klaus, you know, and the people were like, it's fine. We're not going to make you pay for this picture. We're trying to do something new and different. Actually, you know, we'll have to go again. So then real panic sets in because we have got a deadline. This has got to appear in all the supermarkets, this picture, and that's got to go to, you know, go to print. And we've no idea what we've done wrong or how to fix it. So the creative director, a guy called Dennis Lewis, picked up the phone to several photographers. He spoke to David Bailey. He spoke to a guy called Rankin, and he spoke to one or two others. And Rankin and David Bailey both said, take the idea out. It's getting in the way, just photograph the women. Which is a bit of an old, you know, in an agency, we're like, take the idea out, oh my God, take the idea out. And then we also got a really positive response from Rankin, who said, I'd really love to do this because I really get it. I get what you're trying to do. So we commissioned Rankin to take the photographs and we just went and photographed the women. So I'm ringing up the client. We think this is a really good idea. We're going to take the idea out. We're just going to photograph the women. I don't know what else we're going to do. So, you know, real act of faith. Okay, go. So we did it again. And then... I remember it was like a scene from The Graduate, you know, the one where he's going on the glass like that. We had the photographs of the girls. We hadn't written a headline, we hadn't got anything else, and these ads had to go to press. And my account director was banging on the glass, going like this. We literally wrote the headlines in the office, emailed them to the client, approved them that afternoon, the day of the deadline. That's how close it got to the wire. And this was the campaign, and this was the first ad that ran. This lady is called Linda De Maria. If anybody ever says they did the Dove campaign, ask them to name all the girls in the ads, because I can say. I don't know if I'd get all of them. I think I can. I think I can get most of them. That was the campaign that first launched. We knew that we needed PR. As it happened, Rankin knew a journalist from The Times who popped into the set when he was doing the shoot. We had the whole magazine, practically, which we hadn't anticipated on the Saturday that the campaign launched. We wanted PR, but the press went wild, absolutely all over the press. They went wild in Germany, everywhere it ran. There was one country, however, that refused to take these ads because their customers would be so horrified at these shocking images of women. Any guess which country that might have been in Europe? France, that's always what people say. Nope. This is why it's fun. It's not fun if I don't tease you, is it? Next. Italy. Nope.
Sweden.
Nope. Ireland. Go figure. Anyway, so. Well, fine. Okay, so Ireland wouldn't have it because the Irish Colleens were too sensitive to see women of a different size. But what really convinced them was the sales. This was over our sales target for a launch. We were 700% above the target in the UK, 200% in Germany, and I was weeping with relief at that point because, you know, we didn't test it. I was absolutely petrified that people would see these ads and go, oh, that's lovely, but I'd really rather look like Claudia Schiffer and I have the L'Oreal product, thank you. So thank God we got great sales and Ireland capitulated and shocked their women with these ads. We then get briefed for an overall brand campaign, not for a product, but for the whole brand. And by this time, of course, it's then competitive in Ogilvy, so it's the London office who've done all the work so far. And then the New York office, so we're slightly in contention. So it's, I didn't like a bit of competition, if I'm honest. So, you know, we came up with some fun ideas. You know, fun, isn't it? You wouldn't do to an animal what you do to yourself. But you could do that for 10 years. You know, that joke would wear pretty thin after a while. And then the New York office came up with a very American, very Oprah-esque sort of, you know, chicken soup for the soul campaign. Let's make peace with beauty. We think it's nice. That was the image of Queen Latifah that we always quite liked. You know, let's make peace with ourselves, with our bodies, la, 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 la. Quite, you know, very nice. Let's make peace. Let's make peace. Getting a bit edgier here. Let's make peace with our 45th birthday. Let's make peace with our bodies so she doesn't have to. And this time, we researched it, and the customer came back and showed enormous taste and judgment and said, yeah, it's, you know, meh, it was meh. You know, it's good, not great. Customers don't want you to dramatise the problem. They actually want to see, okay, Dove, what have you got? We want to see what you've got. So, you know, the London team are still working away, and I'm saying to Dennis, I want beautybollocks.com, because that's what it's all about. Anyway, Dennis had the very good God sense that God gave him to ignore what I was saying and came up with this idea, campaignforrealbeauty.com. Now, at that time, this was 2004, there were no global brand websites. You know, this was in the dark ages, young people. And we produced the first global brand website. I did it. I remember it nearly brought me to my knees. But we had this idea of campaigning for real beauty. And what was Inspiring us was the debate that happened when we ran the first campaign, because some people liked it, some people didn't like it. One editor said she thought it was a disgrace. Her post bag, because there were post bags in those days, was filled with letters from outraged readers. You know, it created a discussion. So we thought, wouldn't it be interesting to launch this brand campaign if we created a debate? Is she fat? Is she fit? Is she wizened? Is she wonderful? Ugly? Beauty? 44 and hot, 44 and not. Her name's Alison. I found her in Camden Market. She agreed to be in a Dove ad. Bold, beautiful. And that campaign ran globally. That's it in Times Square. We also ran it everywhere into Taiwan. And we also had a sort of, there were no digital posters. We had this text messaging thing, the text, and it would show the results. And we're like, well, what if everybody says she's fat? What are we going to do? Or we'd get down there and be bloody voting for fat, wouldn't we? But anyway, so we're like, oh my God, we're sort of taking risks here. And there it is in Taiwan. And you can see the age of the campaign, because that's a Nokia 3210. And then this is the website. Lots of people think that's me. I don't see the resemblance myself, but I get, you know, there we are. It's not. So this was our global website. First global brand website, I think, that anybody had ever done. We weren't expecting a lot of media coverage. It wasn't that long since the first campaign ran. But it was huge. It was bigger. It was huge. It wasn't just bigger because it was in America. It was actually just enormous. And then they decided to launch the firming lotion in the US. And we would often shoot the ads that were very similar to the ones we'd originated elsewhere, but with local talent, because they would be great spokespeople for the brand. And we were, you know, picked up by Oprah. Now, you cannot buy your way onto Oprah. She will have on her show whoever she wants. You just can't buy that kind of PR, even if you're Unilever. And she took a shine to this, and this is what played out.
Stand by Oprah, you don't see Oprah's mic to the studio. Let's give me a count.
They're causing a stir. Six real women in their underwear. What's the buzz?
Here's that provocative ad that triggered all the buzz. Here's that ad. Please welcome the Dove Girl, Chanel, Julie, Lindsay, Sister. How's this changed you?
Had I known that being in my underwear and poking in my underwear would have gotten me on the Oprah show a long time ago?
Not quite what she was expecting.
Have to hand it to the Dove people. I think it's such a bold campaign. I applaud Dove. I'm gonna go get me a bar Dove soap right now.
And the firming looks.
Whatever, I'll use it all. Because I just think that, you know, somebody had approached me one time about doing a whole cosmetics line, and I had said to them I would only do it if we could change the way women looked at their bodies. Do you think that what you guys are doing is amazing for women, and it changes the way we start to look at ourselves? And thank you, Dove.
So, you know, publicity you can't buy, but sales went up 20% in the US, so that's a big impact just from that one show, you know, the very, very next week. So the internet is evolving. You're getting viral videos. This was one of the first videos that sort of went viral. I mean, there was a bit of money put behind it, which was about how, you know, beauty images are not real. You know, it's about retouching. You may remember that or have seen it. There's been other great examples of these kind of initiatives from Dove over you know, some years. One I particularly like that absolutely cleaned up at Cannes, which you can check out online, is the idea that we're so much harsher on our own selves than other people are. And they got a forensic artist to draw a portrait of a woman from her own description and the description of someone that she'd just met, and then they show the lady both drawings, and of course it's quite touching because, you know, the other person sees her as so much you know, more delightful than you see yourself. We're our own harshest critics, so it was a really good insight. They've done some mad daft things as well over the years, but that was one that, you know, got a lot of resonance, came from an insight, and got massive awards at Cannes. So, you know, they've been at this for 19 years, and here we all are in Exeter, 19 years on from that very first day when we were all saying these ads make us feel like shit. And they keep managing to find refreshing new ways, despite all the new things that there are in the world since. You know, they challenge the portrayal of women in gaming. You know, why does player one always have to be size zero? That ran last year, I believe. And then this year, because Ale is now back in charge, so they're coming out fighting, they did a new viral campaign about the impact of social media on body image. And it's not just a sort of flash in the pan campaign. It's also they've really done research into understanding the impact of that. And they've called it the cost of beauty, and they're putting material out there to help mums, you know, talk to their children about it and do something about the impact of social media on women's self-esteem. And they're signing up for the online safety bill and trying to create, you know, social change in the UK in that way. And then I was on telly talking about Dove this year. Still, I'm actually wearing the same cardigan that I'm wearing now. You know, just so you know, it is me. And just talking a little bit about, you know, one of the women who've shaped the UK ad industry. So I was quite proud to be asked, which was very, very nice. But thanks, thank you, Dove, in the words of Oprah. And then in this just now, they've actually partnered with Nike. To work with celebrities like Venus Williams to talk about the fact that women often give up sport because they don't like the way they look when they do it. So that's, again, a really, really fantastic partnership. And a couple of things about that. First of all, if you remember, we wanted to be up there with Nike, and I think we are up there with Nike because they're partnering with us on something, so that's just awesome. And when... the campaigns were published at the sort of Cannes roundup. Apple came first, but we were second, so there we are. We made it. I don't know, I think I'm not allowed to ask for questions, but I don't know, can people ask me anything?